morning, all of you. Hope you're safe and healthy. Are you all able to hear me? Any one of you can just respond.
Yes, Dennis.
All right. Thank you so much, Captain. So, good morning once again. Thank you for joining us on this webinar on the topic, co-working in challenging times of social distancing. Is it an opportunity or threat? This webinar is brought to you by GACS Bangalore chapter. Man is a social animal. That statement now has become a challenge. All of us wish to come back to normalcy as early as possible, but yes, there lies a new challenging task, a new challenging situation, which is social distancing. We're talking about new normal, but we need to see how the whole human race will adapt to this new lifestyle or norm. As due to this change, there are multiple challenges in the society in terms of our movement, social and public gatherings, work culture, business models, availability of human resources, etc. There surely will be new strategies and innovations, no doubt about it, in every sector, be it health, banking, IT, real estate, public utilities, finance, etc., which we shall wait and see how these can be applied. So today we're discussing something on the real estate and co-working space in specific. Today we have some eminent personalities from the industry discuss more specific on the topic in terms of availability, technology, acceptance by the corporates, design, commercials, all of these things. After the COVID-19 situation, especially when we are more concerned about social distancing. So let me welcome our three panelists who are already with us. The first is Arnav Singh Hussain. He is the head of product and real estate, WeWork. Jairam Govindaya, director of global real estate and facility management, Danske IT. And Captain Niren, director and head global real estate and facilities, Auckland, Asia Pacific. So let me just come straight to the topic now. So Jay, I would like to pose the first question to you. In view of this pro-COVID effect, what do you think is the roadmap for the corporate real estate and workplace as a strategy of the
Thank you. Thank you, Dennis, for this short and very effective introduction of GACS and panel members. And I'm a proud member of GACS Bangalore chapter and the national chapter. Would like to thank GACS for giving this opportunity for us. And I also have my two senior colleagues from the fraternity, Captain Niren and Arnav, on the panel, who are basically going to discuss the whole stuff with me. And just to answer your question, and first and foremost, before I would like to thank the participants who are part of this channel participation, and I would like to thank them. I hope all their families are doing very good. And without wasting much time, I would like to answer your question. You have asked a very relevant question, Dennis, which basically talks about how all the corporates are welcoming their people back after this pro-COVID stuff. I must tell you, things are not going to be very, very normal. It's going to be totally different. The new normal, which we have discussed 4 weeks back, how the whole thing looks like. I would not like to take everything into account. I would say that we are prepared with sanitization tunnels. We are prepared with quarantine rooms. We are prepared with isolation rooms. We are also completely reconfigured and realigned the workplace strategy in such a way that we are going to comply with the guidelines issued by Ministry of Home Affairs. At the same time, what I would like to say is that as a facility manager and as a project manager, it is up to us how we communicate this to the employees and make sure that when they come back, they also follow this without any kind of confusions. That's where, as facility managers, we have a lot of role to play. And I would not like to tell you more on this because there are tons and tons of information on the WhatsApp groups and people are aware of this. And I would like to get along with this discussion in a more interesting way, where I would like to ask Arnav. Arnav is basically a subject matter expert in the co-working and incubation space. Arnav, if I have to ask you, for the last 15, 10 years, we are all comfortable with the traditional way of working, where we had a lot of employee engagement, people were socializing. With the pro-COVID, where do you see, what is the impact on the co-working spaces, Arnav?
Hi, thank you all. Thanks, Jay, for the introduction. And I think there's a huge opportunity in the co-working segment. Flexibility has always been a core of our industry. And I think from a corporate perspective, that aspect of the business will come into play a lot more. As you rightly mentioned earlier, that it's the new normal as such. So I think there's a lot of thought process change that will be required from everyone in terms of how we're going to accept this new normal. We have to come to terms with it that this is here to stay for a bit, and we need to be adapting to the present scenarios. And I think there, that's where the co-working segment comes in to help the industry in this hour of need. I hope Captain agrees with me on this. And
yeah, I think just to add to what Arnab said, I think it's very important for people to understand that, you know, the new normal, once we kind of go past the lockdown, is going to change a whole lot of paradigms, right? I think the whole tenets of corporate real estate and the way we design offices, the way we provide services, I think everything is going to undergo a change, right? I think this is going to become a mindset more than just a process. And I think that mindset will have to be seen. It'll manifest itself in various aspects across the industry, whether it's co-working or the regular real estate space. Absolutely, Arnab.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Now I can hear you. I think Jairam.
So just to add to what Captain also mentioned in terms of, I think it's a difficult period for the industry on a whole as such. But then this is something that as real estate we've faced earlier too. And the last recession of around 2008 comes to mind. But I guess a lot more innovation needs to take place in our thought process as to how we are structuring transactions, let it be normal leases as such, or let it be how we are looking at the co-working space or managed office space, and how we are changing our whole real estate strategy, because that needs to come into play. In 2008, I think, if I remember correctly, majority of the impact was towards the residential segment, and that's when you had new payment schemes coming in of zero EMIs and like staggered EMIs and all that, and the industry took it by the bull by the horn, right? So they innovated in terms of how we were actually selling residential, and I think it's the same opportunity that we find in commercial real estate in today's day and age.
Yeah. Captain, I just wanted to ask you another question. Basically, this question is first to you, then maybe the second half of the question gets into Arnav's kitty. Now sure. That, Captain, you have your facilities in Bangalore, Pune, Bombay, also in Philippines. See, we talk more about employee engagement, employee satisfaction, and we create a lot of agile places in this particular corporate real estate. Pro-COVID, where do you see yourself if you have been told to optimize the space? One is optimizing the space, and how do you balance it with employee engagement?
So I think two things are going to happen, right? One, the perspective is very clear that we're going to have a whole lot of work from home coming into play in the coming short term and the medium term and long term, right? So that's a given, first part. And because of that, what is really going to happen is that you're going to have workspaces which are going to be redundant. You're going to have areas which you're going to let off. You're going to balance that out. I think the most important, the question, Jairam, is really in terms of how are we going to have an engaged workforce in this situation, right? And I think that is and at this point of time is where we have to start thinking about the touchdown office spaces, the co-working spaces which you're going to bring in, because while we can talk about, permanently working from home of certain part of the organization, certain roles, there will still be a need for those individuals to come into an office space and do a touchdown, right? And that is what is going to happen. But more importantly, there's going to be definitely a need for us to reanalyze and revisit our corporate real estate strategy to reduce our real estate footprint from a conventional office space, and how to, and then work with HR and organizational development teams to create an environment where we're able to engage with the workforce, right? And come to a point where we're still going to keep them engaged. But it's a challenging environment, and I think the HR fraternity also is looking at this aspect very, very closely. As we go forward, I'm sure we will have a whole lot of things online. I'm already seeing a whole lot of things going virtually online. You have induction which is happening online. You're talking about training going online full time, right? So those things are already happening. So there will be a whole lot of things happening.
Anav, there is a specific question for you. We have two categories. One is that we have the large corporates who prefer to work from office, work from home, and with the pro-COVID, now things are going to go for a different aspect. That's where some of the organizations say that we don't want to have an office in the same tech park. For example, if they have one office in RMC Eco World, they would like to have one in the other campus. So keeping that in mind, what do you think are now the small entrepreneurs, like the small organizations, they would still like to work from office or they would opt for a co-working space?
See, honestly, there are two parts to this question, right? So one is from the enterprise perspective, and as you rightly said, that you need the flexibility of multiple offices and all that. And as WeWork, what we have been doing in the past 3 years since the entry of our company into this country is basically expanding, ensuring that flexibility option is given. And that is the sole purpose we've expanded the way we've expanded, which is to give corporates, and I'm glad that it's whatever our thought process was in terms of growth for the country is coming true now in a situation like this, right? Because we can help the corporates in the true sense. From a small perspective, I think it's for them, it is even more important that because they feed off the larger system, that they feed off from the enterprises as such. So it becomes even more important for them to be in collaborative spaces wherein they are closer to the end user as such, rather than being in their own satellite offices. Plus, as I said, and what Captain also indicated, that collaboration is an important and integral part. You also mentioned that we are a social animal, right? So, I think all the members who've joined us, we've been staying put at home for the past 1 month. I think a few of us, at least 60-70% of us, are dying to get back into the work stream and get back to meeting people on a face-to-face basis. I don't know whether it's I should be saying this, yeah, but with that 6 feet between us, but connect as a, and now how we are regularizing that is something that each one of us has to think at company levels.
Thank you, Arnav. I think keeping in mind what you said, the order of the day may not be the co-working spaces. It depends from organization to organization based on their business plans. But if I have to ask a very good question, maybe a very valid question to Captain, now that we are almost in the phase one, I'm not saying that we are exiting the phase one of COVID. We are locked in for 6 weeks. And we are going back. And when we go back, I'm sure the kind of challenges we encounter from the management as well as from the employees is something which we need to be prepared ourselves. And there is a lot of money which is involved in this. And my only question to you is, Captain, at the worst scenario, maybe if there is a rebound or if there is some kind of a explosion in terms of number of cases, what is the action plan which we all have to follow, Captain? As an organization.
So I think the basic tenet of this whole situation we are in today, I think the most important aspect is the safety and the health of the employee, right? And of the human being. That's the most important aspect. While business has to run, economies have to grow. I mean, that has to happen. But I think as we go forward, there has to be an element of understanding that you will create an environment, an ecosystem where even if you are in this phase again, or if you encounter this situation again, you will have an ecosystem built in to take care of work from home for a majority of the population, and for, you know, having a small core, as I call it, a non-core and core kind of roles to be from the office. But more importantly, I think from a creating a pandemic layer, right, a pandemic infrastructure layer, whether at a co-working space or an office space, is going to be the most critical aspect of that now. And obviously, this whole thing is going to add cost. Now, whether it translates to a cost per seat in a regular conventional office space, or it translates to a revenue per square feet for co-working. But there has to be, and there will be an impact on cost. There will be an impact. But I think it will be the cost of doing business as we go forward, right? This is going to become an integral part of any planning. It will no longer be called disaster management. It will be called management, right? That is the word for it. We will have to make sure that we inbuilt this into our plans from the design perspective, from an execution perspective. So it'll no longer be called handling a BCP. It will be the BCP. I mean, that's it. That's how it's going to happen.
How will you manage the behavioral aspects of employees, Captain, which is going to be more challenging? Yeah?
Yes, I think that is an aspect which is a completely a new area, right? Because all our systems are designed to handle people when they're in a contained environment. But when they are in a distributed environment, the biggest challenge, I think Arna also spoke about it, is the community piece of it, right? We all long to belong to a community. We all long to talk to each other. You know, we can see each other, and talk to each other. So that is going to become a challenge. I think, if this is going to remain like a constant story going forward, things like touchdown office space, could be a co-working, could be a hybrid between a managed office space and a co-working or anything of that model, has to be brought in where people are able to go and touch down and do work out of that space. But yes, that's a question which our friends in HR have to really look at and understand how they're going to create online communities, how they're going to do online interactions, and how they're going to create and keep morale of the employees up.
I think what you rightly said is we need to create a synergy between the departments and make sure that we all work in a sync and create a kind of a blue book and ensure that this is communicated to all the employees before Absolutely. They check into the office, so that they're aware what is that has been done. I think we as facility managers and project managers have been doing tons of work before they come in. What is important is that we need to communicate this to employees, saying that this is what we have done, and create a blue book and make sure that these guys are taken care.
I think the paradigm also is shifting from the fact that, we said, why do you want to work from home, right? I think the knowledge will become, why do you want to work from an office?
Correct.
So that's how it's going to go. I think Arnav can also add to it.
Arnav, sorry to interject. I have one specific question, which is industry-related question for you. More of a commercial question. We know that the revenue per square feet is a very key matrix considered in the design phase while designing the co-working space, right? Under the current circumstances, there will be a reduction in the people will come back and they will start renegotiating, and they will try and ask you to include a lot of other stuffs like the food management, the transport management. Keeping all this in mind, what is the roadmap or the action plan, or what is the kind of solution you're going to give it to the clients?
So Jay, it's an interesting question. Honestly, revenue per square foot is a matter of concern, not only for co-working players, but also for corporates, right? So it is valid for everybody in the industry, not just co-working, and how best we are utilizing the space is what is important. I can talk about us in particular, but if you've noticed, a lot of our buildings and a lot of our social area is very lavishly designed, and what we are seeing in the post-COVID world, we don't have to do too much of changes to our community areas as such, because they are very well designed and very well designed. Our operations team is doing up in ensuring that we are marking the spaces which should not be used, and we are keeping the 6 feet distance norm into account as far as our common areas are concerned. The matter of concern is in terms of square footage to person, if you look at it, traditional office space would be looking at like one person to every 100 square feet. We are being we manage up to around 1:80 on super built up. So it's not too much of a drastic difference, and majority of it is coming from the community space. Now, how you want to design your particular office space, that will come into account from again the enterprise to enterprise requirement per se. From a design perspective, our buildings are very well designed, like they're modular to the T in the real sense. We have raised flooring. Our workstations are not pivoted to the floor as such, so you can change the configuration of the office space the way you want it. There are a particular, some companies require a table of a certain size. We provide the configuration in a certain thing, and those things can be discussed with each and every enterprise client and change in terms of their requirement, because I think that is something that where we will need to collaborate with the industry to incorporate the and stop being too rigid on what we are offering to. And that's what Captain also mentioned, the mixture between co-working and managed office. We need to be a little bit prudent on the fact that it's a part of the larger infrastructure as we work in a building. So the look and feel has to be aligned with the look and feel of the building. And I think it adds value to the end user also who's coming in there. You cannot have two different distinct office spaces that mars the collaboration concept too. So those aspects are already being taken into account, Jay, to be honest.
Just to add to that, Arnav, I think what is important, I think the question really is in terms of, you know, if the situation is going to continue the way it is for the next 2 years, right? Whole lot of corporates are going to start shedding the conventional real estate office space, assuming they shed, right? Or they convert them to co-working, as we can do that. But as co-working companies, right, I think the intent really here is to understand that if are you able to transform your model to accommodate additional requirements from an office space, right? So while one could argue that if there is just a touch on an office, you would not operate transportation, for example, right? But if let's say a call center comes to work in a co-working space, so there will be an element of transportation coming in. So the question is, as co-working, would you be able to build, you know, those additional services and, you know, obviously additional revenue pipes to get that going?
So, Captain, you rightly mentioned at the end, it all boils down to cost, right? So, from a we are a service provider per se. So, it's not just the space. As I said, the collaboration within our spaces adds on a lot of value, and plus a lot more things can come into play. It's like a tech park, right? So the tech park that you guys are already in, what we're trying to do is we're trying to get the tech park back into a building. So the way it operates remains the same. But yes, there is a cost proportion to it. Now, whether that control should be with the individual company or whether it should be a mass thing, that our teams can sit down and discuss and figure out in terms of how the economics work.
Sure.
But yeah, as I said, it will be a true collaboration between the industry players as well.
Sure, thanks.
Jay, I have Dennis here. I have a question here to you. Sorry to just jump in here, but I just wanted to, you were talking about, you know, well-being and, you know, the social networking of an organization, of people and all those things. Now, I've personally seen your office also, the design and the kind of, you know, the seating and all those things you have done. You have also made sure that the employees' mental health and mental well-being is taken care of. It doesn't look like as if you're coming into an office and, you know, there's an office space. It's a very cool place, all right? So I just wanted to know, when you designed, what did you have in your mind when you actually designed that particular aspect?
Denise, when we work on this new project, I'm doing another project, which I told you in the last webinar. We are doing an agile project wherein we have around 50,000 square feet. Normally in 50,000 square feet, you put 500 to 600 employees. We are not doing that. We are only doing 300 people. It is called as a concept called better ways of working. What does better ways of working does is that you have to put people in teams together. We call them as squads. And squads are sitting together. And in a floor, if you have 25 squads, you are giving them a completely specialized telepresence screen for them. That means these guys will have a place to sit. They will also have a place to sit in other place to work during the other times. That means the whole place is agile. Today, when we meet people during induction, like in the last 6 weeks, we were onboarding a lot of people virtually. You know, there are two questions people ask us when they come to office during induction. They ask us, how big is your cafeteria and how big is your health club? That means today, the motivators are definitely the workplace is which is a big motivator, but they ask for all these stuff. So when we design, we follow three concepts. One is the workplace 2020. Workplace 2020 has 14 line items. The 14 line items talk about all aspects about employee engagement. Then we talk about the agile workspace. Agile workspace means you cannot make an employee to sit in one place and ask him to work. His connectivity and creativity will go for a task. And the third aspect, what we talk about is BWOW, better ways of working, wherein you have been given all tools, the technology tools and also the supportive tools to ensure that if you are in the office for 8 hours, you are provided with all these facilities. For example, he has a mobile, he can order his food. He has a coffee machine next to his squad. He can go and take the coffee machine. And he has a small conference room, which is not a conference room, which looks like a small fun place where you can sit on a small pose and then try and work around and play some games in the TV. So we provide these people 360 degree kind of a facility wherein they can also work. And when they don't want to work, they can engage themselves in different aspects of work-life balance.
Thank you, Jay. I just wanted to put across now, since this is because now we are used to this kind of a mindset, as Captain Niren was saying, now the whole mindset is going to be changed now. So now I'm just asking this question to Arnav. Arnav, how do you think that your co-working space or WeWork is probably working on it to, you know, change or to probably accommodate this mindset in terms of aesthetics, in terms of the color you use, in terms of the design, in terms of ergonomics and all those things? How do you think that in this kind of a challenging situation, you're going to be catering to those things also?
Dennis, whatever I've gauged from what Jay and Captain are mentioning, I think everybody is very clear that flexibility is required in each and every aspect of the way we operate, right? And that is something that as WeWork, we were already doing from the very beginning. So as I said, the product is rightly programmed and rightly designed for to ensure that corporates are getting that flexibility in the way they operate, yet retaining their corporate culture, yet retaining their corporate identities. From a staff perspective, it's not just collaboration within the office environment, that particular office environment. It is also collaboration with other mindsets away from your business requirements, which, as I mentioned earlier, what we're trying to do is we're trying to do a mini tech park in one building, right? So people get that option. Now, yes, the challenging aspect is the social distancing part, which comes up from the COVID scenario that we have seen. And again, from a design perspective, I think we were better programmed and better prepared to make those changes with minimal structural, this thing, what you call changes as such. And if the government lifts up the gag, I think we'll be operational in like 1 day, 2 days with minimal fuss, you know, and that's what our design has given us. So I think the concept is rightly suited. It is the mindset that needs to be looked at now. And I'm glad that everybody is at least discussing as a co-working and a managed office as an option now, in terms of future real estate requirements.
Thank you. Thank you, Arnav. Jay, you can continue now. You can probably, you'll have to.
Yeah. I also want to ask, when I started asking questions to Arnav, everything boils down to one particular thing. which is how best. See, today, Arnav, I don't know the statistics. Bangalore as a city, can you tell me how many co-working spaces we have altogether, if you have some number in mind?
In organized and disorganized sector, there would be at least 200-300 in only in Bangalore, if I'm not mistaken.
And how much is in pipeline, Arnav? Any numbers you have?
Pipeline, to be honest, yeah, I think everybody is stalled a little bit. The market has reached the plateau as such. People who had to scale up have scaled up. Also, I think in the past 6 months, from a co-working segment, not too much of movement has happened.
Okay. So, I just wanted to ask you a question, Arnav. Imagine that you have a company in your, they've already leased with you for 3 lakh square feet pre-COVID. So, they have already passed the lock-in period of 5 years. Now, they are in the second 5 years. They have 3 lakh square feet with you and with Embassy. And now, they come back to you with a business case saying that we would like to renegotiate, wherein we would like to give up this. Out of 3 lakh, we would like to give up 1.5 lakh and would like to have the satellite offices and incubation spaces. Do you have a kind of a package or do you kind of something in your mind where you could come back and give this solution to the existing client or no?
So, Jed, this is from a WeWork perspective and I hope not from Embassy because it could happen to any company with any developer. But yes, to what you're saying, that flexibility is there. And that's why I said it's an opportunity for players like us because we are still looking at expanding, right? But we're looking at controlled expansion, we're looking more towards management deals. Today, cash is the king, right? Everybody's looking at conserving cash flows, conserving this. But if we can partner with any enterprise in scenarios like what you have mentioned, wherein the space is with you and we can come in as partners to manage the space for you or better utilize that space for you. I am more than happy to have these discussions with each and everyone and see what possibilities come out. Because that's the excitement, exciting part about the whole restructuring that will happen in the industry.
So you mean to say there is an opportunity for people to come back to you and ask for a kind of a renegotiation and repackage? There is an option available for the clients with respect to WeWork?
With respect to WeWork or with respect to the lease space is what you're asking?
I mean, a combination of both. If they have a lease space from you, let's take an example of Embassy. Let's not take example of WeWork. If Embassy comes back to you saying that this X organization wants to reconfigure their whole stuff, they don't want to be sitting in one place. They want to have satellite offices, incubation offices. But you will be in a position to give them a package, right? As we speak today.
Not only Embassy, any other developer or any other corporate as such.
Super. Thank you, Arnav. Now, Captain. Captain, are you there? I think Captain has muted. Okay.
I'm there.
Captain, I have one question, which is combination of more related about change management, Captain. See, when an employee is sitting in your office for last 7 years, 8 years in a place, you have given that 3x6 kind of a workstation and he has a draw unit and he has a very good ergonomically given chair. And when you are trying to put this particular community, a part of your community into a co-working space, what is that transformation, transition and change management tools which you need to follow to ensure that the employee engagement is not lowered, Captain?
So I think two things, Jairam. One of the most important aspects in this transition will be between let's say a co-working space or a conventional space from a design perspective, because you'll still have a desk, you'll still have a pedestal, you may have a desk. But I think the important part is how does one adjust, how does the employee adjust to the community environment which is in the co-working space, right? Because that really doesn't exist in that form. It exists in a different form in the office. So adapting to that community change is the biggest aspect. Adapting to the collaborative tools which are going to be available in a co-working space is going to be very important, because the way it's going to work in our limited knowledge of co-working, I think the way it's going to work is that
people are going to be booking things for themselves. People are going to be, are not, it's not just there for them when they want it. They have to ask for it when they want it, and it's going to be created for them when they want it. So that is the difference which will come into place, where people will have to really get to a change management model, where they're able to tell the employees, everybody, and the employees have to understand that this is how they're going to change. But I think the most important aspect is that when people come into a move from a transition from a normal office space to a co-working space, I think is the fact that this is not a permanent office. This is going to be a touchdown office. This is, assuming that 50% of the staff are still going to work from home. So this is going to be a touchdown office. People are going to be coming here to touch and see and, feel something and get back. I think that is the biggest change which will come into play, and that is what will happen. Technology is going to play a very big role in the way things are going to be, services are going to be taken in the co-working space by employees, which they may be or may not be used depending on the company they come from. But that big change will happen, Jay.
Thank you, Captain. Arnav, another thing which we were contemplating yesterday, and which is like we have in RMZ Eco World, we have this Facility Managers Association. Like today, when you look at normal office spaces, there are four verticals which are very important. One is the workplace strategy, where you give a lot of scope for employee to engage and perform and collaborate. Second is very important is the physical safety and security of the people and also the premises. And third is the IT infrastructure. Basically, some of the organization want their separate lines to be drawn from their parent company and ensure that you give them a kind of a space to ensure that they manage this classified information. So do you think, can you, all these aspects of the traditional or agile workplace is inculcated or incorporated in the WeWork, what you guys have conceptualized, or this is the plan in action, or this is roadmap for you guys going ahead?
So Jed, as I mentioned, and just before I answer this question to Captain's point, I just want to add that like the spaces that we are offering are not only swing spaces as such, right? So I see these spaces becoming permanent spaces for enterprises in the days to come, just because we have around 12 odd buildings just in Bangalore. So depending on where the concentration of employees are, that flexibility also comes into the way an enterprise operates, right? So it's not that you're finalizing a space in just one building. You can stagger it in different buildings, and how you roster your employees, then that depends on employee to employee. But yes, what Captain also mentioned was that the safety of the employees is paramount, and that is something that we also believe in. It's a member first kind of approach that we have, and that is something that we are proud of, that our members are happy. So in terms of how they're getting screened before they enter the building, what other spaces that we can utilize if, God forbid, a case comes up, ambulance on call, what is the medical situation within the building, all that is being thought of and being implemented by our operations team. And there's a lot of literature that will come out into the industry from our offices with regards to this, because it's something that, as I initially said, it's something that we have to live with now. There's no antidote to it, there's no vaccine to it. Now, how do we work around it is what is important. To your point in terms of IT security, very valid point. It is something, again, that all enterprises is the backbone of their business, and it is, again, something that we take very, very seriously. From a design perspective, the modularity is already there. As I said, if somebody wants to come and bring in their own lease line, bring in their own server rooms, it can be incorporated in the design with minimal changes as of right now. And then how, again, you want to utilize our lease line, because the infrastructure is already in place, but it is absolutely dedicated to you. That modularity is also there in operation, So it's a mix and match of everything. And that's what the fundamental aspect of flexibility is there, from design to operations to how we execute stuff on ground.
Awesome. I think this is where it makes sense. And this is not a question to both of you. Maybe this is a kind of a statement where, unless Dennis has a question to ask, let me just complete, Dennis. I think Captain and Arnav agree with me that this COVID-19 has brought in a big correction in all our areas of operations. That means we were not prepared for something like this, and we did not have any R&D team to prepare a plan for this. But whatever we are going to do now in terms of mitigating or trying to control this, you think it's going to be, Captain, maybe this question to you.
Yeah.
Maybe you think this action plan or this particular package, do you think it is only for there for a short time, or it is going to be ongoing stuff?
No, I personally believe, Jairam, that this is like a reset, right? You're going to reset your complete corporate real estate and business itself, right? You're going to reset the way you're going to do business. You're going to reset the way technology is going to work. You're going to reset everything, reset your thinking about it, right? And so this is not going to be a short-term story, definitely not. This is something which is here to stay. Yes, the intensity may reduce. Something else will come up tomorrow, but I think the world has woken up to the fact that, you know, after the last pandemic, which was the Spanish flu, this is going to be there. So I think from a strategy perspective, every entity, whether it is in the real estate space or it's in the services space, has to now start thinking about how to reset, how to redo things, because it's going to become paramount important. I was giving the example of, you know, how we would design an office tomorrow, Jay, and I don't know, right? This layer of the pandemic infrastructure, as I call it, did not exist with us today, right? We did not know how to react in our offices today, because the offices are fixed and wired, right? Things like power over Ethernet, I mean, those good to nice to have things will become basics tomorrow, right? And that is going to drive the whole perspective of design and change. But definitely, this is going to reset the whole thing, Jay.
Thank you, Captain.
If I may add, Jay,
please.
This is going to be the new normal as such. And I think all of us will need to contribute in the way we operate and our style of working. I think it will require a little bit of changes from each one of us. From a co-working environment and in specific WeWork environment, I think our spaces are well equipped to handle the situation, and all the safety and precaution that Captain was talking about in terms of the add-ons are in place. So that confidence I can give to the industry today. I know for a fact a few behavioral changes will be required from each one of us, but I think that's very individual and as to how we make those subtle changes in the way we operate. But yeah, there are going to be a few changes for sure.
Okay, I have just to add to that question, right? I think the leading question from there really stems from the fact that, you know, the co-working model really works on, you know, there's a business plan to the whole model, right? So when you are going to build, when you start thinking about how the COVID will transition and how you will, you know, get into that model, do you see a cost increase happening from a build perspective? Because, you know, if you're going to put in a 6-foot office for every employee of the client you're going to have in space, is that going to add to cost, or is going to, so what are your thoughts around that?
Captain, it's subjective, right? So if, and I might be wrong here, and please correct me if you think otherwise, but like if the same changes are required in a corporate setup also, it'll incur cost.
So, yes, absolutely.
The principle, this thing is, cost is important, but it's also the time, right? So as I said, the design is already modular in nature to in its truest sense. So whatever changes that are there in terms of as far as the end user is concerned can be incorporated in a faster duration. Now whether you want to utilize two desks for one person, that is an individual company's prerogative. Whether you want to use 4x2 desks and use two 4x2 desks rather than a 5x5, it depends from company. Now, how that is going to get built and how that is going to get incorporated from a commercial sense is anybody's guess right now. It'll have to be, like as I said, even if we had to redesign our corporate offices today, and from 100, if we take it to 160, 170, there would be a cost involved. But in the execution part, I'm sure because of the modular nature of our buildings, the cost would be much less, and that will, of course, will get passed on to the clients.
Okay. Thank you, Captain. Thank you, Anna.
Dennis, are you there?
I think.
Abul? Dennis?
Dennis? Okay, by the time Dennis comes back, Captain, I have a short question wherein
yeah.
we are all now in the process of going back and making our offices tuned to the requirements of this COVID-19. I just wanted to ask you with respect to wellness, with respect to wellness, what are the measures you have taken, Captain?
So I think fundamentally, I think everybody who's looking at this space and how do you sanitize, clean, more or less they fall under the 3-4 buckets, right? There is a pre-opening story which has to come into play. There is a whole lot of fumigation to be done, primarily because your office space has been locked and kept for the last 30 odd days. Your systems are not operating. Your air conditioning is not working, except maybe in your critical room areas. But you have a critical amount of staff who are in the office to manage your engineering systems, etc. So I think first step, fumigation has to happen on day 3. You need to do cleaning post that, running air conditioning to fumigate, purge in the fresh air and things like that. And then you need to do a completely deep cleaning. But more importantly, I think all these are physical manifestations, but more importantly is how will you get staff back into the office? What are you going to put on the floor? How are we going to manage the pantry, the office, the cafeteria? How will people, this is a very fundamental question. I'm sure Arnav will also have the same challenges as you, Jairam, and everybody else on this call.
Absolutely.
How do you ensure people more than, depending on the size of the pantry in your office, how would you enable only 2 people to be in the office, in the pantry at all point of times? How would you manage the flow in the office? I heard, in another conversation that people should have anti-clockwise and clockwise movements happening, right, within the office, which is the concept of the 6-feet office. But I think those are the things which have been put into place, Jay, right now. We have looked at multiple options in terms of how do we operate, so we're thinking, right, no cafeteria to operate in the first initial weeks. We are just looking at to do, packed food to employees who come into the office, and same for support staff. Carry out fumigation, carry out sanitization, getting an 18-point checklist implemented, and so on and so forth. But I think the measures are more important in terms of how do you regulate employees in the office and how do you regulate movement inside the office.
Thank you, Captain. Very comprehensive it is. Trust me.
Thank you, Captain. And we have just about 10 minutes now. So am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, Dennis, please. Yes. Please.
Okay, fine. So one question I just had wanted to post it to probably Adna from my side. Now, since the whole situation is going to be changing, especially related to the real estate, and because we are talking about co-work space and all those things, just in case if we feel that a particular corporate says, okay, fine, I have my leased premises here, which is either in locked-in or maybe another 3 months or 3 years or 6 years or something tenure is there. Is there a possibility that probably you can convert that leased or a managed property then to a co-working space, provided the corporate allows that, okay, fine, you can make it as a co-work. This is basically to make sure that, the premises has been, optimized and utilized to the fullest, and the availability of, the premises at different locations, whichever is there. I hope you got my question.
Yeah. So, Daniel, I think Jay had broached upon this topic a little bit earlier. Right. And my answer there also was a big yes, I think. And that's where, from a real estate perspective, I see an opportunity for my company, at least in this segment as such. And it's not just taking over the whole space. Now, that modularity in terms of how the deal is also structured, I'm working with my teams internally as to how we can present it to the different enterprises. Now, if you need some more space for your future growth, which you haven't deciphered as of right now, but it's that future growth is still not in line with the quantum of space that you want to that you have leased out. So I could take a portion of that space on a managed setup where I'm managing that whole space for you. And like, it could be a revenue share kind of model. How the leases are structured, that each corporate would know, and what would be the way out in terms of people like us collaborating, that each company will have their own thought process. But as WeWork, we are more than happy to look at these aspects. It will be a sustained growth for us for sure. It's not that everything that comes to us, we will be signing up. It has to make sense to our growth plans also, and where we need to be. But yes, from a discussion point of view, we are more than happy to sit down across the table and come out with constructive solutions, which are win-win for both.
Aval, you have any question, Aval, because you also are in the same kind of segment. Do you have any question?
So Dennis, I think, if you can hear me.
Yes, double.
I think it's going to be a very interesting trend going forward. So while in short term, there's going to be a lot of upheaval as far as the whole real estate scenario goes. But I think in the long term, the way that the trend goes, I think a lot of corporates are going to start looking at options of flexibility and agility in their whole real estate scenarios. And therefore, the whole co-working model is going to kind of become a little a successful model going forward. And yes, definitely there are going to be a number of asks from the employee perspective as well as from an organization perspective in terms of higher standards of sanitization and how do we maintain a social distancing and so on. But I think a lot of enterprise clients have also started moving into taking areas earmarked specifically for them within co-working. So that's also going to be there. I think the whole, when we look at the whole build-up scenario, I think there's a lot of technology also that probably is going to come in into the co-working spaces also as a facility in terms of automation of doors, voice commands, activated controls, and so on. And that will also facilitate. So as we move forward, I think there's a lot of technology that's going to penetrate into the whole co-working environment also, which is already there to quite an extent, but I think it's going to increase substantially over the next couple of months.
All right.
I completely
agree. Thank you, Aval. Thanks so much. Yeah. So we have another question basically. It says basically on the compliance part, what about the license under the Shops and Establishment Act, which is basically provided to the different organizations? So when they all come together into a co-working space, how does that get affected? Is there any exception? Is there any new law, any new guidelines, especially post COVID-19, in case if it is so? Question to Arnav.
So as WeWork, our system is of a membership model. So we have a Shops and Establishment distinct certificate for the whole building as such. The companies who come in as members. So it's like a membership model. It's not a sublease model. It's not a, a lease model among within the same building. So I don't think individual this thing would be required. And it's a flexible space. So the whole purpose of having this is the flexibility of you taking that space and removing that space. So from a building perspective, I've got all the sanctions in place. We are leasing only buildings which are like, meet the standards of any enterprise thing. So OC is there, fire and OC. And we are very, very stringent on those aspects. We have a very solid operations team which manages the buildings, and they're managed as any other corporate tech park as such. And from an operational perspective, as I said, it's a membership model. So this thing, then how that can be worked out, we can sit and see the scale in which the space is being taken up and model that transaction in accordance. But individually for the building, it's a membership model, so that Shops and Establishment is not required.
Yeah, Thank you, Arnab. Anyway, the other participants, you can post your questions on the chat board. We don't have much time, just got about 5 to 6 minutes. So I'll just read out those questions to the respective person. There's another, probably it's a suggestion what Madhu Menon has given. He says the behavioral changes among employees may require formal training. So training capsules need to be formalized accordingly, and this will be a continuous process. I think it's a very valid point, you know, wherein, because it is going to be a new normal, just sending across probably a circular may not work, because practically it is going to be a difficult task. As even Captain Naren was saying, you know, there are many organizations where they are making it a one-way movement. You have to work only in one direction, and you know, non-touching you know, utilities and things like that. I think this training part also could probably bring in something. Any idea, Jay, what you can...
I think it's very good point. What Madhu has said is very good point, because the challenge what we face when we go back is only more related to the employee's behavior, for which if you have a kind of a sophisticated training schedule and make them that this is what they need to follow and create a kind of a blue book and give it to them, make sure that they follow all this. Because we can do everything and anything. At the end of the day, if the employees do not follow what we have given them, then it is going to be a colossal disaster. People, I mean, one guy is enough for us to, for the entire flow to make it contagious. So training is a must, and it is part of the bringing back. It's like bringing back the wave one. You should have this training stitched and make sure that these people are aware of this particular stuff.
I think it's important, just to add to that, Dennis, is very important that, you know, this this deep briefing, as I call it, the deep brief and the brief, as we call it, on what the new normal is going to be, has to be done to every person entering that office space. Whether it is a third party staff, whether it is somebody who's going to clean your office, somebody who's going to manage the office, or somebody who's going to operate your office. So I think everybody have to be really briefed about it, and they have to train. I think more from an overall business training perspective, they all have to become virtual. I think that's the reality.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Jay, and thanks, Captain. We've got a couple of other... Okay, one more aspect here. Arnav, the question is here. Okay, fine. We are today in a situation, yes, where it's going to be a complete change of the normal and all those things. Let's hope and be positive that we come back to our original normal, not the new normal. Then what happens at that point of time to the co-working space? Although there was, till before COVID attack and all those things, yes, the co-working space was definitely flourishing, as you were also saying that it was going on fine. What happens then when it becomes absolutely the original normal? And do you think that people are going to be thinking that, okay, shall we go to the conventional way of leased or a managed office, or shall we go to the co-working space? Has the co-working space been more about it? This is more of in a general, not specific to COVID-19, but just in case post the COVID and everything becomes the original normal.
So, you know, it's a slightly difficult question, because I don't think we predicted COVID either. So I don't know what will happen post COVID, or whether the actual normal will be achieved. But to that question, my answer would be, see, the fundamental of our space is community, you know, how we're bringing in people together. And that doesn't change. That fundamental doesn't change. And even if I'm biased, people might think that I'm biased, but once people come into the space and experience the space, it's difficult for them to leave. So that's all that I can say. I would much rather say come. It's a good opportunity to try out people who were like thinking about co-working but stuck to traditional real estate. I would strongly recommend them to at least see what is in store here. And to whatever Captain was mentioning in terms of being prepared and all that, honestly, like in our buildings, we've already done that, you know. So that ease of operation comes in. Yes, at the end of the day, we are also not monitors in terms of like how each one is behaving in the building. Each company has their own responsibility, and each individual who's in that building has their own responsibility to how they operate. But the basic guidelines and the basic implementation of those guidelines have already been done, you know. So from a facility point of view, from a real estate point of view, the enterprise company doesn't need to think on those lines, because it's my responsibility to ensure that it's being delivered to you. And when all that comes in and the employee is happy in that environment because of the add-ons that are coming in terms and the productivity system, I don't want to move out of that space.
Yeah.
Thank you, Arna. Thanks so much. But anyway, see, as you rightly said, you know, we never predicted COVID-19. Now, we being in this kind of a situation, in fact, I don't know whether to call fortunate or unfortunate or something like that, but we, this generation, has been probably part of this particular situation, which is probably once in 100 years or so, like what he said, Captain was saying that it came once in 1920. So, yes, there are a lot of things that we are learned during this particular thing. But I think what we have learned from this particular situation is also that what all wildest thing we can predict. You know, maybe we are sleeping and next day morning we get up and we find out that, you know, instead of fourth floor, we are actually floating on the ground. So it is like the prediction has got no limitation now. So there is no basis for that. You can just predict anything. Especially if it is an epidemic, or especially if it is this kind of a thing. So, Captain and Jay, both of you, I'm just as a facility manager, as a people who probably you can anticipate probably come. In fact, in this point of time, probably I found the facility team, the facility manager, the real estate managers have come into effect like a insurance company. The insurance, you just have to keep on paying the premium. Until there is a kind of a damage, until there's kind of an accident, until there is an incident, you don't know the value of the insurance. So probably the facility manager, real estate, and all those people have come into that kind of a level where we are now being given more, inclination towards listening to them. So again, Captain and Jay, what do you think that we should be all in a position to predict in future? Not only in terms of epidemics, but in terms of any kind of a thing. It's a very big question, very wide question, but just as a thought.
Jay?
Captain, I'll let you take the first question.
Sure. So I think what has really happened is that, you know, all this while all our modeling, all our strategies, all our modeling, whether it is a business continuity management or BCP or whatever you want to call it, has all been based on what we have known, right? We have never visualized and prepared for something which is unknown, right? And that is the biggest challenge I think we will face as we go forward. I think what the predictiveness primarily was driven from a fact that how your business operations are being done, or how your transport is operating, or how your analytics are being brought into, et cetera, et cetera. I think that is the where we're starting today. But this predictiveness in terms of saying what will happen to the environment, and I think this is the bigger question which is to be brought in today, in terms of the environment, in terms of how the climate change is being brought in. So I think there's a whole lot of questions which have to be thought through by a lot of people in terms of thinking what the modeling will bring through. But today, I can't forecast what is going to be happening in the next 15 years or next 10 years. I can talk about, because I have no uncertainty, I don't have any certainty today, how my business is going to grow, what is going to be my, because we're talking about resetting business by, the whole business by 2 years, right? Maybe about 8-9 quarters. So there's going to be a lot of recovery which is going to be coming into place. But I think the more important aspect is from a facilities management perspective, it is more important that each one of the facility managers, all the real estate guys, really think about going back to the basics, looking at those things which they thought were nice to have, and start getting those implemented. Because predicting these kind of pandemics is not going to be easy and fair. But what we can do is to get ready at the best possible scenario. Jairam.
Yeah, just to add to what Captain said is, Dennis, like if you are doing a project in software or building a code, you always do this predictive analysis. Unfortunately, in facility management, we don't have that. But, being facility managers, we have that inbuilt skill wherein if something has to happen in an organization, which everybody thinks impossible, then they come to facility manager asking for a support. And we just somehow pull it off. So this is something where we have a situation like this, where we need to do some kind of R&D. And as I said you earlier, we are the ambassadors for the employees' health and wellness. We have to make sure that even though we have to put in some extra hours, train our teams, train others, and make sure that we arrive at a win-win situation.
All right. Thanks, Captain and Jay. So I think the new normal is predicting the unknown. So as far as facility management is concerned. So absolutely. That is it. So anyway, Arnab, so you would like to close on any kind of a closing note or something like that? So on the whole thing.
So I would just like to say that, like what you rightly said, new normal is predicting the unknown. And I would just want to add that flexibility is a key part in that. Flexibility and agility. One needs to have those components in all our thought processes now as to how we adapt to the new changes. We shouldn't be getting used to whatever is happening, and whatever has happened in the past will change. The duration of this change will be much faster than what we've seen earlier, and we need to be ready for it. And I think as humans, it's important that we don't lose the human touch. We interact and we collaborate and we meet each other, because then it'll be difficult for us to operate then as human beings.
All right. Thank you, Arnav. So, anything, Captain Jay, from your end as a closing note?
I think, just to catch up, first of all, thank you for all the panelists. I think it's very important for all of us to really understand that the new normal has to be ingrained in all of us. It's not just about what we will do from a design perspective, what we'll do from a build perspective, but I think the reset piece, right, has to be truly ingrained in all of us. It has to become a philosophy. People have to understand that the new normal, we will not, whatever standards we have today, whatever Ekand Ishray or Ashray or whatever we have today, everything is going to undergo a change, because the basic tenets of of operation is being changed. So people should be ready to change, question the status quo, challenge the status quo. We have to innovate. And I think the biggest thing which will happen across the industry is going to be innovation. I think co-working is one such innovation. But there's going to be a whole lot of innovation coming into play with respect to operations as we go forward. So I think that is the key. People have to reset and people have to start thinking about how they're going to move forward. Jay.
Absolutely. I have nothing to add. I just want to say something. Stay connected, stay updated, and make sure that you guys don't get into wrong information. And we have managed for 6 weeks. We need to manage for 6 more months. Let's be very, very honest and very candid and very, very effective, so that we all will be winners at some point of time.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Arnab, Niren, and Jay, for joining in this particular webinar and sharing your knowledge, your insights, and your experience. It has been a great session. We have been getting a lot of and positive feedbacks also. So it's very nice, and especially you all coming on a Saturday. And I don't know if you would have heard. Because Saturday being the holiday, generally, it's a relaxation time. So I really appreciate that you all took out time and do it. In my house, I'm sorry if the cooker whistles have been blowing, because all this while in this particular webinar, I've lost the count of the cooker's whistles. So I'll have to redo everything. So anyway, thank you all. And thank you all the participants. They were very patiently listening, and I just noticed that the number of participants right from the time when we logged in till now have been consistent. There has not been dropouts and all those things, so it is fantastic. Thank you all so much. You have all taken up time out of it, and most of you are aware of GACS. We are a group of people who are basically forum which is working for questions from across various sections of corporate services. So we provide a lot of opportunities, be it networking, be it sharing our knowledge, experience, and all sorts of support and help. So do visit our GACS website, which is www.gacs.world, and just get connected, be a member, and it's been great. It's been great that you all joined in, and we would be planning some more webinars in the coming weeks to make sure that we are all engaged through these webinars. There are some which are coming on travel, some coming on HR and all those people, and there are a lot of things which are coming up. So thank you all of you. Thanks a lot, and have a nice weekend. Be safe and be positive. Although COVID is also positive, but I think our positiveness will defeat the whole COVID positive and make it negative. So let's be hopeful and be positive, and have a great weekend. Thank you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So bye. Bye. I love. Bye.